6:33. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The Texas flag?
Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to the Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Thank you. At this time, we'll have invocation with Mr. Brad Sutton from Point Church.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for this evening. Thank you for the good work that will be done. We thank you so much for 2016 and all the things that were accomplished and the way that our schools and our students took great leaps forward and the great things that are promised in the year to come. Father, I'm always reminded that wisdom is something very close to your heart. It's something you want us to ask for, and so we do ask for wisdom because not all good ideas can be done. Good ideas can be done, and not all ideas are good ideas. And thank you, Father, for the wisdom to know the difference. So we ask for that for this meeting and this coming year. Father, we always, when we come together like this, we ask for blessings on our children. We thank you, Lord, for custody of them and for the responsibility of planning for them. And Father, we just pray blessing as they interact and as in a world where schools have seen some pretty scary stuff happen. We pray, Father, for your guidance and your protection that those things would not happen here and that the people charged with their safety and their education would have their eyes wide open to those kinds of things. And we trust you in that. And lastly, Father, I want to thank you for each person in this room tonight. These are people that care about their community. These are people that are not content to let others make decisions for them, but they want to be right there. And I pray, Lord, that you would give them peace and patience and wisdom and understanding to accomplish those things. We thank you for them. Thank you for hearing us. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Mr. Sutton. Yeah, will you do roll, please?
Dr. Lowell Strike?
Here.
Mr. Jason Olson?
Here.
Ms. Leanna Harding?
Here.
Mr. David Montemayor?
Here.
Ms. Melissa Myers?
Here.
Mr. Alejandro Flores?
Here.
Mr. Dan Blackwood?
Here.
Mr. DeLeon English?
Here.
Thank you.
Do we have any citizen input at this time?
No, ma'am.
All right, I'll call for a motion for approval of minutes for the November 14th regular meeting.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion on the minutes? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Motion carries. All right, we're going to move some agenda items around just a bit. We'll go to Superintendent Spotlight next up. Dr. Strike.
Thank you, President Myers. We're going to start out, and I'm going to go with the Superintendent Spotlight with Little Elm High School Students of the Month. And our presenter for that is Principal Renee Pentecost, and she will be ably assisted by Coach Brown. They're going first tonight, kind of out of order. They need to get back to the girls' basketball game. That's, first district games, so they wanted to make sure they got back to support those. So we appreciate your flexibility.
We really appreciate y'all allowing us this opportunity to tell you about some of our great students. I have done something a little bit different this month. The students that we are recognizing tonight have been doing some special things in our community. And people have noticed and written me. And so I'm gonna share the communication that I have received. So at this time, if Adrian Barrientos will come up, Devin Dotson, Deshaun Gilbert, CJ Seal, Nick Terry, and Brady Wade, come on up. These young men are part of our football program, and Coach Brown is here to help me give out their awards. And the email that I received was from Misty Chestnut, who is an assistant principal at Lakeview Elementary. And so this is what she had to say about this group of young men. I just wanted to take a moment to brag on a group of your young student athletes. Earlier this semester, I reached out to Coach Brown in regards to a group of young men on our campus who were in great need of mentoring. Coach Brown accepted the challenge with enthusiasm and quickly gathered a group of his captains to come meet with us despite being right in the middle of football season. The young men he assembled were respectful, helpful, and highly motivated to impact this group of students here at Lakeview. They are spending their morning dismissal time working on organization, self-esteem, self-control, and character building with these students. As a former high school teacher and administrator, I know that there are a number of other things they could be doing with their time, but they have chosen to invest in these young men instead. We are so grateful to have Adrian Barrientos, Devin Dotson, Deshaun Gilbert, CJ Seal, Nick Terry, and Brady Wade working with our students. A special thanks to Deshaun Gilbert for coming during the week of PSAT to meet with our fourth graders. Our students and staff were incredibly impressed with him. He has stepped up and offered to meet with additional students in order to ensure every kiddo that needs a mentor is able to have one-on-one time. We would love to nominate them as your next Students of the Month. They have clearly shown a commitment to leadership and service in this community. And then she said, we'll be sure to keep you posted on progress. So first of all, I want to thank Coach Brown. Every time there is a request for help, he is always one of the first to say, how can we help? And these young men, you can tell from the note from the assistant principal, have really been making an impact. And I'm so proud to have Coach Brown on our staff, who is instilling in our students the importance of giving back. And when we're giving back to students within our own district, that just then increases the influence that Coach Brown is having, not only on our campus, but on generations to come. So at this time, if you will help me, please. So here's Adrian. And Devin. And Deshaun. Just a second, let me get my last one, because I've got one more to come up. I also received a letter from the community about this young lady. It says, during the general election held on November 8, 2016, I served as the presiding judge of Precinct 2030. The location of this polling place was at Cesar Chavez Elementary School in Little Elm. Those of us adults who worked the election had the honor and privilege to work with one of your students, Greta Jacobs. Come on up, Greta. She was very knowledgeable of the election procedures and performed very well all the jobs to which I assigned her. She did a particularly good job checking in the voters, the most difficult job in the entire election process. Not only did she do what I asked of her, she volunteered to do anything else that was needed at the time. Her positive attitude, courtesy, and friendliness to voters and workers alike helped to make for a most enjoyable day. All the other workers share my views of Greta's work and work ethic. I would be very happy to have her work with us in the future should she so desire. Thank you for allowing her to have this experience on such an eventful election day.
Thank you to that great group. Appreciate the recognition. It just, you know, goes to show just ongoing how many times we talk about how many great kids we have in the school district. And when outside people recognize that, that just confirms it. So congratulations to every one of those folks. Next, would like to welcome Debbie Clark to come up front. And Debbie has the Oak Point Elementary group this evening and spotlighting that campus.
Good evening, honorable school board members and Dr. Strike. We feel very blessed to be here tonight. And I just want to say thank you that you give us this opportunity to spotlight some really wonderful activities and programs that we have at each campus. And tonight, we're going to spotlight the LINK Project. And so I'm turning it over to my kindergarten teacher, Ms. Cortez, and first grade teacher, Ms. Ortel Reed. And we have some special guests that will be coming up in a minute, some students that would like to speak to you, and a parent, Mr. Alvarez, will be up to talk with you. And we have a special video for you.
And once again, thank you, Dr. Strike and board members, for allowing us to come tonight and talk to you about the LINK Project. We would like to begin by thanking Dr. Strike for bringing this program to Little Elm. Dr. Strike has been so generous and supportive. Last year, he provided us with all the needed training throughout the year to prepare us for the implementation of the program this start of the school year. His generosity also provided all of the kinder and first grade teachers at Oak Point, Hackberry, and Chavez Elementary with kits filled with lots of fun and innovative stuff to be used during indoor recess. He also purchased several books for each teacher that Dr. Debbie Ray from TCU recommended for us to read that will help to better understand the reasoning behind the purpose of the LINK Project. One of the books talks about the positive effect of outdoors and exploration of nature. In one of our trainings, Dr. Debbie Ray shared with us that by providing kids with the opportunity to play outdoors regularly, it allows them to explore the wonders of nature and the great outdoors. The students have already discovered the wonders of nature as we have observed them exploring playing with worms, frogs, ants, ladybugs, and crickets, to mention a few. She also shared with us that she has even seen this to be effective with her college students at TCU. She shared that she has seen her students looking out the window during class, and that's when she knows it's time for brain break, as she likes to call it. And so they proceed to go outside and explore the wonders of nature, which she says can also serve as a stress reliever. Dr. Ray and her staff have been very supportive and have provided us without hesitation great feedback and any questions or issues we have encountered. Now we will tell you a little bit about the Link Project and why it's beneficial to our schools and district.
All right, the CDC defines recess as regularly scheduled periods within the elementary school day for unstructured physical activity and play. There has actually been a downward trend in time dedicated towards recess due to a belief that the more time in the classroom results in better achievement performance. Other countries have demonstrated that academic achievement does not suffer but improves when including time for recess and physical activity. Benefits of recess include increased attention focus, improved academics, improved attendance, decreased behavioral diagnosis such as anger, ADHD, and anxiety, improved creativity and social skill development. The Link Project also has an educational program we include called Positive Action, and it promotes an intrinsic interest in learning and encourages cooperation among students, and their philosophy includes you feel good about yourself when you do positive actions. So we have four recesses spread out over all day across all content areas. We have, of course, some struggles changing, like always. At first, it was very challenging for both teachers and students to get used to this schedule and fluidity of throughout the day. But we also struggled also fitting in all of our instruction time with all the four recesses. But as time went on, we've managed to make our day flow more smoothly throughout the day, and students have also gotten a lot better at making in and out transitions to go to recess a lot faster and smoother. And we've been told by Dr. Ray and her colleagues that as the year progresses, that our day will go as smooth as clockwork. So we just want to thank you for your time, and please enjoy this video that we, with our wonderful students, playing the Link Project. Yeah.
I got this feeling inside my bones. It goes electric, baby, when I turn it on. Off to my city, off to my home. We're flying up, no ceiling when we in our zone. I got that sunshine in my pocket, got that good soul in my feet. I feel that hot blood in my body when it drops.
Why are you guys
doing?
I'm building a castle. Okay.
And it makes me happy, and it keeps me focused in class, and it helps me solve our problems outside.
Cause I got that sunshine in my pocket, got that good soul in my feet. I feel that hot blood in my body when it drops. Ooh,
I like recess because you have fun with your friends.
The way we rock it, so don't stop. Under the lights when everything goes, nowhere to hide when I'm getting you close.
Sam?
Yeah.
Invite some of our students to tell you themselves what they like about recess and what they have learned using this curriculum called Positive Action, and that is the social and emotional component of the linked program. My name is Alejandra Galan. I'm one of the first grade teachers, and I want our students to introduce themselves.
Jackson, I'm in first grade. My school is Oak Point Elementary.
Hi, my name is Alexa, and my grade is first grade, and I go to Oak Point Elementary.
Hi, my name is Olivia Vandevert. I'm 7, and I go to first grade.
Hi, I'm Mia, and I go to Oak Point Elementary, and I'm first grader, and I'm 6.
My name is Spencer. I go to Voice Electric. I go in fourth grade.
So we wanted to know if you have some questions for them or you want us to facilitate a little discussion.
I have a question. What is your favorite thing to do at recess?
Who wants to answer that question?
My favorite thing about recess is we get to exercise more, and when we come inside, we focus more.
What are your favorite insects?
Ladybugs.
I want to ask them also, what is it that do you like about having the extra recess? What is different from this year to last year when you were in kindergarten? What do you do more?
We didn't get to exercise as we do in first grade. Last year we only got to do one when we didn't get to be that active, but in first grade we're getting to be more active.
I don't know if you have the opportunity to see this little young lady on Channel 5 on Friday afternoon. She was telling us how recess is helping her do better in the classroom. Alexa, do you want to talk about that?
We can have more recesses by having more time to be more objective and learn about more stuff, and by outside we can have a lot of brain breaks.
And I want to ask them, what do you know and what is positive action? Who wants to answer that question?
Thinking positive, acting positive, and feeling positive.
How does that help you? What kind of difference has made that for you? What does that for you? That make you feel, how that helps you at school?
It makes me feel good, and I really like it so much.
And how has positive action help you being a, okay, Jackson, do you want to say something?
About the four recesses, we get to have fun.
Do you get to be fit?
Yes.
How does that help you be a good friend, and how does that help you solve problems? Who wants to tell me that?
It gives you more time to learn outside.
What happens if you make mistakes? Is it okay to make mistakes?
Yes.
Why is it okay to make mistakes?
Always fix them.
How do we fix them?
Just trying to fix them a lot.
Just keep trying. Do you guys want to say anything else? Do you have something else? Do you love recess?
I like recess because you can play with your friends and play games.
Does it teach you to be a better friend?
It's really nice to other people.
That's really good. Thank you, guys. You did great.
Thank you. Well, first of all, I want to take the opportunity to say thank you to the board and also to the Oak Point Elementary for the opportunity to come and represent all the parents that participate in the Watchdog program. I have experienced firsthand what the kids and the beautiful video they show us have really represented. It's very insightful as you get to see how this program is really helping our children to grow more confident, to be problem solvers, and also just to help them to be better prepared for the future. One of the things that I would like to stress today is I have definitely seen how they have the program help them to be focused on task. As a watchdog, I have spent time with them, and as they are preparing the task or they're performing a task before the recess, they know the recess is coming, so they focus on task to make sure they complete the task on time and they're ready to go and enjoy the recess. But also the one thing that I have seen, as they finish their recess time, everybody follows direction, instructions, and they go back to task. They know and they have learned and they have seen the motivator of seeing the recess time and go back and do their job. So that's a great thing that I have experienced firsthand. Also, I have seen how this program is helping them by develop and reinforcement their social skills. As you got to see, everybody speaks about having fun with their friends. And that's a great thing to see our children to get to know other kids from different cultures, different contexts, different backgrounds, and they spend a lot of time together. I have experienced that firsthand as well as I stand over there and just watching everybody to have a lot of fun, and then all of a sudden just seeing a six-year-old coming to me and asking for my name and asking about what I'm doing and inviting me to play with them. So that is, if you guys cannot tell me that's a social skill, I mean, that's something else, and that's something marvelous that I have seen with the children. The last thing I also wanna talk to you that I have seen and experienced is for sure the development of freedom and exploration that these kids are enjoying and experiencing every day. I get to see them running all across the field, just playing, and just being creative with the different kind of games they wanna play. As you get to see, some of them, they enjoy to play tag, some of them, the monkey bars. As a matter of fact, my daughter, Alexa, she used to be afraid of the monkey bars, and now she has overcome her fear, and that's one of the favorite things to do now, to go and play with the monkey bars. But I have not only seen that, but I have seen even kids being so creative and inviting new games, like playing tag and doing monkey bars at the same time. And that is just the power of creativity that they're doing and the great things that they're enjoying with this program. So finally, once again, Dr. Strike, thank you so much. Thank you, the board, for the support to this program. Thank you to the Oak Point Elementary, the principal, and your staff. Thank you for the great things that you guys are doing. And I just wish that we get to see more of these programs coming to our children and our children to become, be more prepared for that bright future that we know that God has ahead of them. Thank you so much.
They have a little gift, artwork that they had done regarding the playground in recess.
Dr. Strike, I just wanted to also thank you on this. I know, me personally, I was thrilled to death when you brought this program to our attention. Approving it felt like a no-brainer, and usually in, I guess, a government field or whatever, it takes forever to see results. So seeing that this is already a huge success, and I thank you for coming and sharing this, because this is even better than expected, and confirms that this was definitely a no-brainer. So thank you, Dr. Strike, very much. For, I guess, just for bringing this to us and allowing us the opportunity to share it with our students.
All right, perfect. Again, thank you to Oak Point Elementary, especially for the students coming. I'm glad that you're enjoying the program, and we know it makes a big difference in many other places, and it's great to see it happening here. We'll see the fruits of that in not just the academic side, but the social side, as the kids talked about it. There are so many great benefits, and in today's world, for kids to be able to even get out and get a little stress relief and the brain breaks and running around is so valuable. And so I'm just very appreciative of Mrs. Clark, as well as every one of the faculty members that take it on, because it is a change, and they have so much pressure to teach certain things. And for them to be flexible and work with it and work through the program is they're the heroes in terms of making it work for our kids. So thank you to you guys. And still me. And speaking of heroes, Mr. Roberts has got the stage now. Recognition of Little Elm Firefighters.
Thank you, Dr. Strike. I was hoping you would call me up here at this time, because it is perfect timing. But before we move on to our heroes amongst us, I do want to say that has to have made my week, and I know I can speak on behalf of our staff. You know, so many times we know our work is focused around our learners, But to actually see the high school students up here tonight and then these amazing Oak Point Elementary students, every one of us, I think, we're sitting on the edge of our seats and smiling. You know, it's what brings us back every day, and it's just an incredible feeling. So on behalf of our staff, we know that that's made our week and just an incredible, incredible night and celebration for those students. President Myers and Board of Trustees, good evening. And I have the great honor to talk about a group of men and some of our heroes within the community. And first, I wanted to start off and talk about just real quickly one of our core values, which is a culture founded on the highest quality of character. And we even go as far enough as to define that character, and we talk specifically, one piece we talk about is compassion. And so the story that I would like to share about this group of men really defines that compassion. And so in October, we had a Lobo learner. His name is Frainer Chavez, and the Chavez family could not make it here this evening, but they were invited. And so our eighth grader, Frainer, was riding his bicycle to school, and he was along El Dorado on the side of our fire station. And according to Frainer and his words, he was quoted that his tire stopped. Now, whatever that means, we can imagine that it just, whether it's broken down, fallen off, whatever, it was dysfunctional. And so the firefighters at Station 1 came out, and they knew that he was running late to class. And so they actually explained to him and loaded him up in an ambulance and brought him to Lakeside Middle School and got him to class. And they said, we will come back. We're going to work on this. We will come back. So later in that day, around seventh period, they came back and they actually worked on it. The firefighters did. And they had Frainer get on it again. And he rode it for a second, and the tire stopped working again. So at this time, the firefighters knew that he needed to get back to class. So they said, you go back to class. We will take care of this. And so they pitched in some money, and they actually purchased a brand new bike for Frainer and brought it back later, I believe, in the day, and actually had it hid behind a fire truck, called Frainer out of class or at the end of the day, and actually revealed that brand new bicycle to him. And he was so pleased and knew that there weren't going to be any more struggles getting to school. And so we wanted to take this time to honor our heroes. And the group of men, we obviously have a great support. It's a brotherhood. And all the gentlemen in the back are from Station 1. And specifically, we have Fire Chief Roach. We have Chief Roach with us. But we're talking about Lieutenant Cliff Anderson, Trent Espinoza, Roger Konechny. Where's Roger? That's pretty good, isn't it? I had help. So we phonetically spelled it out here, so I got that. And Dalton Irby. So we want to tell you thank you, and we're going to have you step up along with your other brothers in Station 1 and come up, and we have a token of our appreciation. And we want to give you, along with the school board and Dr. Strike, we want to give you a coin of excellence. And again, this is just, this is from us to you guys, and want to tell you, tell Chief Roach, thank you for your leadership, and thank you guys for creating an environment and creating a culture of compassion and generosity. And you know, our vision in Little Elm ISD is to create a destination district. And through your actions, not only are we working on that, but in partnership with y'all, you guys are creating a destination community. So we want to say thank you on behalf of Little Elm ISD and tell you how much we appreciate you. So Dr. Strike, President Myers, Board of Trustees, if you would like to come up and hand these coins of excellence out to them, that'd be great. Guys, if you mind, go right up in the front and we'll get a picture taken with y'all.
All right, well, we will move on to action items, discuss and approve the annual financial report. Mr. Anderson.
Sorry. Board of Trustees, appreciate your E-Step. Our external auditor, independent auditor, is here to present our August 31st, 2016 financial audit.
Thank you, board members and Dr. Strike, for allowing me to present some highlights of the financial report for the year ended August 31st, 2016. I'll just cover some of the highlights. I think you've had the report to look over, and of course, if you have any questions, feel free to ask me. But first of all, on page three and four is our opinion on the financial statements. And in our terms, it's called an unmodified opinion because there's no modifications. This is the highest opinion that we're allowed to give our profession. So there were no problems what the report says. And then there's a section there that's called Management's Discussion and Analysis. It just highlights some of the key numbers of the report, and I'll go over a few of those with you as we go through here. But I won't go into detail on those. There is a year-to-year comparison of the government-wide numbers, a net position, and changes in net position, so you can see from year to year in that report. And then it starts off with the basic financial statements. And this is a statement of net position, and this is on a government-wide basis. And what that means is it takes the fund financial statements, which we'll get to later, and it adds capital assets, and it adds long-term debt. So you'll see those numbers in this report, whereas when we get the fund financial statements, you won't see those. But you can see the net assets of the district there. And there's one business activity that the school has, that's the child care program. So that's in the middle column there. On the next page, 16 and 17, is the statement of activities. And this just, again, on a government-wide basis, which is all the funds of the district combined. And you can see the expenses by function. And then where the revenue comes from. You charge for some of your services. One of the key ones, food services, in there. And then you have operating grants. And then down below, you have your property taxes that come into the district. You have state aid, foundation money, and so forth. So you can see where the bulk of your money comes from. And the bottom line there is that during the year, you had a positive increase of almost $3.4 million to your net position for the year, which is very positive. Then beginning on page 18 is the balance sheet for all governmental funds. And these are the fund financial statements. And you'll notice here that the capital assets and long-term debt is not included in these financial statements. And you can see the major funds, the general fund, the debt service fund, capital projects, and the other funds. Those are detailed later on in the report, mostly special revenue funds. And then there's a reconciliation between the two different methods, the government-wide and fund financial, and it shows you how you get from one to the other, how it's converted. Page 22 and 23, a statement of revenues, expenditures, and changes in fund balance for those same major funds and non-major funds. And I'd just like to point out that for the general fund for the year, you had a positive increase under this method of almost $3.8 million. Again, you increased your fund balance by that amount of money, which, again, is very positive. Page 34, again, is just a reconciliation. It shows you how you get from one fund financials to government-wide financials. Page 25 is a comparison of your actual general fund revenues expenditures compared to your original budget and your final amended budget, which you amend throughout the year, and then at August 31, you have your final amended budget. So it compares that to the actual numbers. So you can see how you did compared to the budget. And you can see that you did very well, that you actually had more revenue than you projected, and you spent less in those different categories than you expected to, which resulted in your positive increase in your fund balance. Page 26 is just a statement of net position for the proprietary fund. That, again, is your child care, and I won't go into detail on those. On page 29 is the agency fund is included there. You also have some private purpose trust funds that have been given to the district to manage. Those are listed there. And then there's the notes to the financial statements, and I won't go into detail on those, but there's some there's the statement of capital assets on page 41 that shows the capital assets of the districts and how those changed during the year. There's also a detail of the different forms of debt that the school district has some maintenance tax notes and capital leases, and then the overall debt structures on page 44, so you can see your bonds outstanding and the future payments required there. You did have a bond issue during the year, and that appears there. There's also quite a lengthy note on the pension funds or the teacher retirement system, which the school district is part of. And you recall last year you had to start recording the district's share of the outstanding liability on that, and that's reflected in the financial statement. There's a long footnote that goes along with that, and I won't go into detail on that either. And the other thing I'd like to point out on page 60, we talked about those other funds, and they're detailed back here, so you can see all the other special revenue funds of the district, and they're listed mostly by the different grant types that you have. Those all have to be accounted for separately. And then the only other thing on page 70 and 71, schedule of delinquent taxes receivable, you can see your outstanding taxes, what you levied for the year, what you collected, and you can see your receivable balance is a very small amount compared to what you levied for all those years. So you're doing very good on collecting your taxes. And the final part back at the back, page 77, is a report, another independent auditor's report on internal controls over financial reporting. And this is required for when you have federal and state funds. And then on page 79, another report over compliance because you have what's called major federal funds coming to the district. This year it changed to $750,000 for any one grant, which y'all have in some of those grants. Again, it says that the district is in compliance with those rules that are spelled out in those grants. Again, there were no findings. If there were, we would have pointed that out on page 81. Page 83 is just a detail of those grants, federal grants that came into the district last year. Overall, it's a very good report. Your school district is in sound financial condition. I would like to thank Beth and Grant and staff for all the help that they provide during our audit. Very helpful to us. It's a very positive report. Be happy to answer any questions you have.
At this time, do I have a motion to approve the a motion to approve the annual financial report? Any questions, discussion from the board?
No. Just really excited. We have a great financial report, independent audit, so a great job to tax rate staff. So,
all right, any other questions? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jerry.
All right, let's see, I'm so confused.
We're at the
number 8, reports of the superintendent.
We've got 3 reports of the superintendent. We'll do A and B. C, Representative Fallon, we put that underneath here. He'll be here when he can get here, which we think is going to be closer to about 8 o'clock. So if we can adjust our agenda to finish whatever item we're on at that time. So would like to go ahead and start with Dr. Ashley Glover with our English language learners report, please.
Thank you. Good evening, President Myers, Board of Trustees, Dr. Strike. As I was sitting there and preparing to have a moment with you, I thought, how can I make my presentation more adorable or entertaining or fantastic or proud? And since I can't necessarily do those things, I do have the pleasure of working with one very special group of our learners in our district, and that's our English language learners and also the staff and teachers that support them every day. So this is your annual ELL report that I'm going to share with you briefly. So what we have here in front of you, this is our students by program type. And so as you know, in our district, we have 3 different types of ways that we can serve our English language learners. That includes traditional ESL, one-way bilingual, which is for our native Spanish speakers only, and then two-way bilingual, which is for native English and native Spanish speakers. So as you can see, it's a little bit easier to see in your board book, but we have a very large amount. We have 56% of students are in our ESL program, and you can see the number there, 762. We have 340 students who are in the one-way dual language program, and then it says 240 students in two-way dual language. But in actuality, that's just our limited English proficient speakers, or should I say our English language learners. We actually have an additional 240 native English speakers that we support with them as well. So we have closer to 500 students in the two-way dual language program. And we also have 27 parent denials. And last year, Mr. English, you asked me to look into why do people deny those services. And so what we did is we kind of kept track of that over the year, and it truly was because families felt like it was in the best interest of their child to learn in an English-only immersion environment. And so any time that we felt like there was a barrier in terms of you would have to be at another campus other than your home campus, we always provide transportation and things like that. So we kept up with that. We'd love to see that be a smaller number, but we also respect what our families decide in terms of best educational setting for their child.
Okay.
Yes, absolutely.
Do you find, is that a successful model?
Which, our two-way dual language?
No.
Our one-way dual language?
The
27? Absolutely. So what I did, I felt like someone might ask me that. So this morning I pulled it up. We have a variety of students ranging all from kindergarten, and our oldest group being 10th grade. Our students that are in 10th grade are seeing some pretty good success, but I went to see when they joined us, kindergarten. So they've had a little bit of time for that immersion. And so it truly varies by child how they do. Sometimes parents make the choice of the English immersion because they feel that really will work best. So we see success, you know, it depends on the child. We see success there in one way, two way, and an ESL, dependent upon the child and all the affective domain filters. Okay. This is the exciting part. We have 1,369 English language learners, but we have 50 languages. And the reason this is so exciting to me is because most people outside of our district think we only have English and Spanish. And it's not the case. As you can see, 70% do speak English, 26% Spanish. And our third language coming up is Urdu, okay, which is an Indian language, which is really interesting because most surrounding districts and in Texas and in the United States actually have Mandarin Chinese coming up as their next largest population for language demand. So you can see here, these are just our top six: English, Spanish, Urdu, Swahili, and Vietnamese. And then 3.1% of our students speak other languages. We have some really fascinating ones. We have Ewu, Akan, Kannada. It's really interesting. Every time we get a student, we look to see, you know, what is their home language. And so the exciting thing for us that get to work with our students is our diversity is incredible. For having 7,400 students, we have this incredible diversity right here in our own town. So really neat things there. This is an at-a-glance look at our program placement right now across the district. You will see we started at the top here with Brent, and they have one-way bilingual, which again, to remind you, is native Spanish speakers. And then I know that you can read down, but you can see that Hackberry supports one and two-way in ESL and Oak Point as well. And then we provide ESL, of course, at all campuses for any learner that might need that. The purpose of having those at those particular campuses are we're about to embark upon our, for the two-way, we're about to begin our ninth year. And so we started that program at Hackberry and at Oak Point, and then we'll be growing it in the future. So we support students with ESL at every campus. Yes, sir. We do. We've been looking at how we can best support our students and the demand and the need. And so we're looking at where the interest is, how many students would like to participate, and then also looking at how we can serve our students either at their home campus or closer to their home campus. Right now we have, because we have Hackberry and we have Oak Point, we do provide transportation for students, but we're seeking something as that third section a little bit more centrally located. So yes, we do, and I can provide you with additional information in a written format if you'd like. Okay, certainly. Okay, for ELL support, we have 51 teachers that work with our English language learners, 3 instructional paraprofessionals, and then student support personnel, myself. We have very thankful that you guys helped approve our bilingual coordinator, Magdalena Silva. She's done an incredible job working with our teachers on instruction and building the capacity within the classroom, and so that's been wonderful. And then also we have Yamile Quintero, who is our parent liaison and our homeless liaison, who helps support these students as well. And me, I'm number 3. Our instructional focus, originally what we had done is when I put this particular slide together, I went through and I did based upon data, hard data results. But then I took a step back because it may be 1,369 students, but it's 1,369 individual children that aren't just a particular number on a piece of paper. So when we backed up and looked at that, we thought instructional focus is going to be specific to each student and then each campus. They're going to be different needs. You'll see social studies, science, and writing. Those are some areas. We're always working on all of our areas, but those are some areas that we are seeing some targeted focus, depending upon the campus, for the needs of our learners. So we do have some actions for improved achievement, and I want to keep these pretty brief, but if you do have additional questions, we can provide additional information. We are working on sheltered instruction, and if you're not familiar with sheltered instruction, that is where content and language are brought together, and students are taught not just the rigorous information, but the language support comes in to help really help students understand what content they're learning. And so when that comes together, that provides sheltered instruction opportunities for students that need it the most. Data-driven intervention, looking at what students need, looking at the whole child, not just particular STAR or MAP scores, which we do absolutely look at, but what is the situation with the child? What do they need help with? What mentoring situation might be appropriate for them? So we do look at that. Instructional coaching, both within the campuses and from Ms. Silva, our bilingual coordinator, and then really focused student support. Something that we've looked at for each campus is we know certain students need support. It may be to achieve more. Maybe they've already done some really great things and they can do even more. Maybe they're strong in certain areas but could improve even more if we help with little changes. So that's been a real look at student by student by student, and we're really finding some change and success with that. And that is my last slide. What questions may I answer for you?
I don't think it was questions. If you could just maybe, the one thing I would like to see possibly is maybe some statistics at each campus. You know, you said which classes or which groups are being taught. If we can maybe see some numbers behind that, that'd just be interesting to see.
Numbers of enrollment, achievement,
yeah, enrollment,
all of those things, yeah, absolutely.
Be nice.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Certainly. Well, we do appreciate all of your support for our English language learners and for the staff that support them.
Thank you, Dr. Glover. Up next, Advanced Academics Update with Ms. Ball.
Good evening, President Myers, trustees, Dr. Strike. I just wanted to share with you a few glows. There's kind of a theme going on with this evening as far as celebrating all the great things that are happening in our district with our students. And when I started looking at our advanced academics programs, and this is gifted and talented, this is AVID, pre-AP, AP, and also dual credit. So that's what goes under this umbrella. I started seeing that there are just a lot of things to celebrate, and so that's what our focus is for this. So these are the four programs that fall under the advanced academics umbrella. And a gifted and talented program, this was called WIN, and we have rebranded that this year. One of the teachers that one of our GT specialists called out her winners, and she said, I'm going to have all the winners come out. And then she had this moment of, wait a minute, who's left if I called out all the winners? And so they've decided to have the students that are in the GT program rename the program. So they are having a contest to come up with a new name to rebrand the Gifted and Talented. So right now it's the Gifted and Talented at LEISD. And so you'll see the WIN logo on some things as we rebrand it, but they're gonna have a party in February, I believe, to unveil the new name of the program. So we provide services to over 350 students that have been identified as gifted in a variety of settings. And so that's, you know, being pulled out for services with GT specialists to being clustered and also through pre-AP and AP courses. There are some really great things going on in the gifted and talented classes. So one of our specialists, our lead specialist, Roxanne Clark, as some of you probably know her, she's been able to pull in some industry specialists to come in from Apple, and then also Cecilia came in and worked with some of her students, and our digital learning facilitators came in and taught them how to do the newscasts and how to do different camera angles as they work on their projects. And so they're bringing in some real world aspects to the projects with their curriculum. All three of the GT specialists just attended their national conference and got some really great ideas to share with each other, but also came back feeling really great about the things they were already doing and felt very confirmed in the ideas that they had been sharing with their students already. And one of those things is the Challenge Lab. We had a couple of school districts come and visit our Challenge Lab so they can kind of recreate that in their own districts. And if you're not familiar with that, basically it's open to any student. You don't have to be identified as gifted and talented. It's, you know, if you're moving ahead, if you are finished with your coursework, you get to go to Challenge Lab and play challenging games and try to answer these difficult questions working in teams, and it's just a way for you to not have basically free time. So you're challenging your brain in addition to finishing your coursework. So the next one is AVID. So AVID stands for Advancement Via Individual Determination. And so basically AVID's goal is to close the achievement gap and to get all students, especially students that are underrepresented in college, to start thinking about college being an opportunity for them. And AVID Elementary is something that we have started this year. So this is actually Hackberry's second year to implement and Brent's first year. And this again, they just kind of reaffirm AVID's mission to have students be college ready. And they are implementing these strategies school-wide. So by the time they get into middle school, where they are in an AVID elective, they've already been exposed to AVID strategies, to the binders. They, you know, a lot of the college t-shirts on Mondays, that kind of started from this AVID culture. And these school-wide structures we've also built into our professional learning. And so a lot of our teachers have been exposed to these AVID structures as well. AVID Secondary, very proud of them. I asked for some glows from them so I could share it with you guys, and it was 2 pages long. And I was like, I think I have 8 minutes. So I was able to kind of condense it down. Some of the biggest things is that they have 40 student ambassadors, AVID ambassadors, and that was out of 150 students that applied. So these are students that are going to be the ones that go and talk to anyone that comes and visits. When they go on college visits, which they've done already twice this year, they're the ones that do the speaking. They have taught other students how to do the AVID strategies, and AVID is way more than just binders, but you do hear that a lot because they really stress the organizational piece. And then we also have AVID Weekly, which is, you know, reading strategies, and that's being used across the board. We've also brought AVID to DAEP, which makes me really happy because a lot of times when these students have, you know, gotten in trouble, they've hit this obstacle for whatever reason and they are sent to DAEP, they go back and they haven't necessarily gained any new skills that are going to make them any more successful in that traditional classroom setting. But using the AVID binders and gaining those skills, they're going back to the traditional classroom with this organizational setting, knowing how to be successful in class. And we are, I mean, when we bring this up to other schools, they're like, can you talk to us about how you're doing this? This is our first year to implement, but Bill Bush jumped right on it, and all the DAEP teachers have now been trained, and if they haven't, then they're slated to go to Summer Institute this next summer. So that's a big glow right there. And then also we have some reports set up in Focus that are going to track our AVID students to see who's enrolled in pre-AP and AP courses so we can see their success moving forward. So AP, really our biggest goal is to make sure that we have access and equity in our pre-AP and AP courses and that they align with the belief systems of the College Board. That is extremely important to us as we move forward. And advanced placement is not about little mini professors and putting students in college classes in high school. It's about college level coursework in a supportive environment so they can be exposed to rigorous work in an environment where they have the support of teachers and peers. And so it's our job to make sure that they have scaffolding and systems in place to make sure that they can figure out what their passions are and they can discover their interests and reach their full potential. So part of what we're doing is with our guaranteed and viable curriculum, we're creating a pre-AP AP skills alignment document or guide. That way you know what you need to be able to do in the sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade, all the way up as far as skills are concerned to be successful. So any student that decides to take an AP course, whether they had pre-AP or not, can be successful in that class. So right now we have 161 students enrolled in pre-AP courses at the middle school and 87 at Prestwick. We have 606 pre-AP students at the high school and 538 AP students at the high school. This is a big glow. We have increased the number of students that are taking the AP exams. So research shows that taking an exam, right, that is a lot of students will take an AP course and they don't see maybe the point in taking the AP exam. Maybe they don't have the confidence to take the test. They're nervous to, you know, about what they're going to make on the test, and so they opt out for whatever reason. Some of it has to do with financial hardship, and so we do have scholarships, and students maybe don't realize that those scholarships are not based on any kind of financial hardship. You write an essay and there's money there for students to be able to get their AP exams paid for. But we had 150 additional exams taken this year. And then you guys were witness to how many students made threes and higher and how many, we almost doubled the payout that we did with our AP scholarships for those students. And so that was definitely something to be proud of. At the high school, they set an excellence target that by spring of 2017, 70% of all the students who take an AP exam would make a three or higher. In spring of 2016, they are within 3% of reaching that goal. So they've already increased dramatically in that area. So the last piece here is dual credit. Really our biggest goal is just to make sure that we are providing all of our students with whatever it is that they are passionate about and whatever pathway that they need to be successful. And so we have 383 students right now enrolled in a dual credit course. So our partnerships are growing, student opportunities are increasing. You know, as we continue to educate our students in this, you know, we're well into the 21st century. We have to be flexible and we have to continue to grow with them and provide them opportunities that that are going to give them the tools they need to be successful. And so this is, as our CTE program grows, our dual credit program will grow as well. So that's something that we're very proud of, as well as our Pioneer Promise. That was something that we had. And then chart your course is the last piece. This is not technically in my realm. This is more of a partnership between CTE and the high school, and actually the middle school as well, but we do an advanced academics presentation. There's a dual credit piece to that, but this is a great event, and I'm sure that you're all aware of it. This is the save the date, so January 25th is when Chart Your Course will be next year, but just 1 month. So this is fifth grade and up, but I believe we've opened it up to fifth grade and up, and they get to, they're gonna have passports this year, and they will get a gold star for every booth that they visit, and they're going to chart their path to their future. So this is a really exciting event for students, and this is all just part of, you know, supporting them and helping them find their way. That's all I have for you. Do you have any questions for me?
I do. How can AVID be pushed out to more of our campuses? What is the plan to have it made better? I know you said that a lot of the tools are being used across, but is there any plan to have it more integrated into the campuses?
Yeah, well, we want to make sure that we're doing it with fidelity, that the strategies are being used with fidelity. And so fidelity, what that means is that nobody has to get lucky. So the systems are in place to where everybody has what they need. So right now, we will not be adding another elementary school next year. So we'll have Hackberry in their second year, or in their third year, excuse me, Brent in their second year. And then at the middle school, they're doing it by strategies. So instead of adding another school, sixth grade, seventh grade, and eighth grade will all have binders. They'll all use marking the text. And so instead of doing it as spreading out as more campuses, we're doing it as more strategies. And that's the way that we can make sure that everyone is properly trained. Summer Institute is kind of expensive. The other portions of it are manageable. So if we do it in a responsible way, then we can continue, it can be sustainable. And so that's our way of making sure that we can get those strategies to everybody and do it responsibly.
When you go back to the dual credit, when we partner, who do we actually partner with, and how do we ensure that the credits that they receive actually transfer to different universities?
Well, it's very clear that they should always talk to the universities themselves, that we are not a go-between. We partner with NCTC, TWU. We also have OnRamps, which is University of Texas. And then there are different ones that change depending on what courses they are offering. And another thing that's changing with the course guide is that we're not going to be as specific with the institutions that we partner with, because those do change based on the course offerings. So it is very clear, and we actually move that to the top of the course guide that says that you have to talk to the institution, you have to make those connections, because those things are always changing. But yes, you have to, you know, that communication is extremely important to make sure that those courses, that the credits are transferring. Most every credit you get will transfer, but we as a school district are not going to make any guarantees about that.
Yeah. Amanda, is it not true, though, that in terms of transferring to state universities, that that's a given?
Yeah, I mean, state universities, yeah, yes, so. But we still didn't make that statement in our course.
Because there are common course numbers that will transfer by law to any state university. What you get is, if you're going to certain universities, and it's true of AP courses also, is that not all universities are going to treat those the same that are either private or outside the state of Texas. So you could go to most Ivy League schools, and an AP course is not going to get you AP credit, college credit. What it may be used to is to use for admittance into the university or admittance into an honors program. So that one's a little more wishy-washy, but the advantage of the dual credit for our kids going to state universities is that's a given.
Yes. And I think that's the thing with the AP scores as well, with the state saying now that a three can be...
And that's just recent, last legislative session, I believe.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And that's another thing, is that you have to be very careful, because not all schools will accept a three, but they can now. And so students heard that and they said, oh, okay, I just have to get a three on the AP exam and it's going to be college credit. And that is great, but you have to make sure and you have to communicate that as well. So, and that's what those parent communication nights, that's why those are so important, to have those. And we do two sessions that repeat, and then we have a dual credit representative from NCTC. They are our largest partner right now. They come to chart your course and do that, their speech themselves. So.
Any other questions?
Just a couple comments that as we look forward, I know Mr. Montemayor asked the question about expanding of Avid, and appreciate Amanda's response in terms of wanting to make sure that when we do it, it's fidelity and sustainable in what we do as we kind of first got into that. But we are looking, am I correct, at different options of how we might expand that?
I can jump into that.
Thank you.
The answer is yes, but what we want to do is look at funding. We want to look at how we're going to pay for it, because it is rather expensive to get it started. So that's one thing Dr. Nick and I are going to be talking about, is looking at funding and possibly looking at the use of title funds. So we're going to look at options. So the answer is yes, we're looking at expanding it, but we can't give you a definitive answer on how that will be expanded and which campuses it will go to.
And it's very different at the elementary, because Avid Elementary, there's like a subscription to the materials, but at the middle school and the high school, there are tutors. And those tutors are part-time, they go under like the subcategory, but they're employees. And so that's a budgeting, and this year it was, you know, that's another piece of it as well. It's an amazing program, and it's something that we are never gonna let go of, but it also is something that we have to be smart and strategic about the way that we implement. And also, like I said before, doing it right and having it be meaningful. If every teacher is doing a strategy in their classroom, that is going to make an impact, and then we go from there.
It's a strong research-based program, so that's why we expanded to the elementary. We know that for the dollar spent, there's a good return on that instructional dollar spent, but it is expensive, as Amanda said, to get it where it needs to be. So we're looking at those options, as Mr. Gallagher stated.
And just those kids thinking, a lot of those kids have never seen themselves as being even college-going. They've never even thought of themselves as going to college, and now they're thinking, now they can tell you what college they want to go to, and they're in the third grade. I mean, that's a big change, you know, so.
Very good.
Thank you, Amanda. I was going to make a comment. The Avid just had their Avid National Conference for this year.
About that.
You want to talk about it?
Yeah, we had one of our assistant principals at the high school, and I'm telling you, there were a lot of glows. And our site coordinator at the middle school, Gina Armstrong, they both presented with our previous director of professional learning, Ashley Helms, and they did, their presentation was hitting the reset button, because we've had Avid in this district this is the ninth year at the high school, and it was one of those things like looking at the data, we're looking at everything, and it's like we need to kind of reset, and that's what their whole presentation was about. That filled up twice to the point where they asked them to come back and present again on Saturday. So they were a hit.
Yeah, I saw a couple of the different tweets that came through, but to show you they must have made an impact, I'm looking at tweets coming through when the conference was going on, and I see this one, and it's not from our district. It's from a middle school teacher at another district. I thought, dang, she stole our words. But then I noticed it's in quotes, said, we need to engage, equip, and empower students to realize their full potential. That's my mantra. And I thought, well, that rat, she stole our thing. And then all of a sudden, I said, well, why did I get it? Because it said at LEISD, at Lowell Strike. So she was crediting us, but I thought somebody got to her, and she thought that's what it's about. So
people kept going, oh, that's good. It's like, I think they kind of
Thank you, Amanda.
So at this time, do you want to hold off for after closed session, Mr. Fallon?
Yes, I think the last text that came through that he's even running later than he thought, so it's probably going to be closer to 8:30 to 9 o'clock before he gets here, so we're good to go.
All right, well, at this time, we'll go into closed session at 7:59. At 9:45. Action item up next, discuss and approve the District of Innovation Resolution.
All right, good evening, President Myers, board members, Dr. Strike. Thank you for letting me talk about the District of Innovation Resolution briefly. We are asking the board if the board will approve the resolution designating Little Elm ISD as a District of Innovation. What the, where's our clicker? What the District of Innovation is, it was, it's a concept that was passed by the last legislature, the 84th legislative session. It's House Bill 1842, and what it does, it gives school districts, traditional school districts, the same opportunities as charter schools have, opting out of some state regulations. Some of the benefits that we may see in Little Elm, it provides local control for us to make decisions that are best suited for our needs and our kids' needs. Allows for customization of whatever we want to do, specific programs, curriculum programs, may decide to do something at a specific level, maybe just high school or elementary or middle school. Provides for autonomy and flexibility. Some of the exemptions that we could pursue, and again, all of this depends on, first and foremost, your approval of the resolution, but then a committee. And this really is going to be driven by a committee that we, or actually that the board appoints. Some of the possible exemptions are a uniform start date for the first and last day of school. So it's depending on right now, the way the law reads is we cannot start before the fourth Thursday in August. So I'm sorry, fourth Monday, not Thursday, Monday. So this would allow for some flexibility in terms of that. The minimum minutes of instructional, the instructional day, that could open up some possibility for some unique learning opportunities for our students. Teacher certification, one thing that we believe here in Little Elm is we do believe in hiring highly qualified teachers. So if this is something that the committee pursued, we would steer them in the direction that we would only want to look at our CTE program or that flexibility, because sometimes it is hard to find if you want to offer a program like diesel mechanics. Hard to find a certified teacher who has that skill necessary to teach that class. Also, teacher contracts. Currently, there is a requirement that teachers are under contract for 187 days a year. This could free a district up from that requirement, so they could actually work fewer days than 187 days. And there could be some benefits to that, depending on the needs of the district. And then certain purchasing and contract requirements. What we can't opt out of are district governance. Obviously, we need a school board. We can't operate without a school board. That's a requirement from the state. Curriculum, we can't move away from the TEKS, the standards. We have to stick with those. The state assessment system, we have to follow our current assessment system as it's designed. School finance, we can't opt out of that, and also federal requirements. Anything dealing with federal funding, federal programs, any requirement there, we cannot opt out of. The process is, and tonight we're gonna ask you to approve a resolution. Then following that, there would be a public hearing for public opinions, open it up to public opinions, and then you would appoint a committee. And then that committee would go and develop that plan. So when when that committee is formed, we would go through and talk about the pros and cons of what we believe as a district would be beneficial for our kids. And then that committee would be a good representation of not just teachers, but of community members as well. And then the plan is developed. We would come back to the board with that plan, let you look at it. We would have to post it for 30 days. And then after the 30 days, the board could vote on it to approve it. And then that plan would be in effect for 5 years. The nice thing about this is it doesn't have to be approved by the Commissioner of Education, TEA. They just need to be aware that we're pursuing it as a district. In fact, here's a flow chart of the process. The last time that we discussed this, there were 38 districts that were listed as DOI districts on the TEA website. It's bumped up to now 48. So districts across the state are taking advantage of this and pursuing this for a multitude of reasons. One common reason is calendar. We see that a lot. If you start looking at districts that are pursuing this. And with that, again, we're asking the board to approve a resolution.
Okay. I need a motion that the Little Elm Independent School District adopt the resolution to initiate the process of designation as a district of innovation as defined by the 84th legislative session in House Bill 1842, to begin the process of considering whether to move forward with being designated as a district of innovation. Do I have a second?
Second.
Any questions from the board?
I have a few questions. Okay, so the first question I have, so it gives us more flexibility in terms of calendar start time, number of days of instruction, teacher contact, etc. What are we giving up? I mean, is there a give and take here, or is it purely just we get more flexibility without giving anything in exchange?
That is a good question, and we're really not giving anything up. This was designed to give us some of the same opportunities that charter schools have. You know, if you look at the regulations that we're under, we're really under quite a few more regulations than charter schools. And obviously, some of those things that we just can't opt out of, like testing, I think ultimately we would love to see the state offer some of those opt-out possibilities, but we're really not giving anything up. I think the key is what we want to do is ensure that if this is approved and we move forward, what we want to accomplish, because ultimately, you know, the calendar is an easy one, but we want to look at what can we do for our kids, how will this benefit our kids, and that's why it's important to have teacher representation on there and community members as far as just having a group on that board, right? On the board, committee.
Second question is, does this, you know, now we have the number of minutes of instruction. So one of the flexibility we have here is with numbers, you know, minimum number of days, et cetera. Do we still have to adhere to the number of minutes instruction?
Yes.
Does that kind of offset the flexibility of school time or school instruction or anything?
Yes and no. We're still bound by the 75,600 minutes that are required for the year, but what this allows is flexibility in terms of the school day, the number of minutes, because currently it's 420 minutes. Minimum of 420 minutes per day, and where this would be a benefit, an immediate benefit, would be for our AIMS Goals program, or DAEP, not requiring students to have to adhere to that 420 minutes. I think depending on the program, there's some benefit there.
So if those groups of students are able to go lower, is it going to push those higher to still get 75,000 on average, or does every student have to have that, or how does that
work? It comes down to the scheduling. It doesn't come down to the individual student. So it's, if our scheduling is designed in such a way to where our instructional minutes equal out to 75,600, then we're ensuring that that's happening. Something that, you know, we might want to look at down the road, again, it depends on the committee, is what are the possibilities? If we can shorten the school day for one group of students, could we change the structure of maybe an online instruction for students using DOI? Again, this all comes down to what does the committee want to do moving forward and what's best for our kids.
And then the release of the teacher days, I mean, I know right now we had it because we, you know, we constricted our calendar, but we still had teacher days that had to be filled, you know which fiscal year did it fall on and things of that nature. It releases us from some of those restrictions.
Correct. And that's right. That's a good point. Currently with the 75,600 minutes, our teachers, it doesn't match up with what we require of teachers. We require teachers to be under contract for 187 days. A possibility could be to reduce the number of days. And again, if we did that, we'd want to be cognizant of teacher pay, and we certainly wouldn't want to reduce teacher pay, but we could actually close that gap of the number of days that teachers are here and the number of days that students are here. Because at the end of the day, what we want to do is ensure that when teachers are here, you know, we're providing professional learning and the time is well spent.
David, just go back to your point. You know, one of my big things is giving or potentially having the opportunity to provide teachers more planning time. Potentially give them back some of that planning time that allowed them to create more high and higher fidelity instructional time. So, would be interested in something like that. Modify the days so that they can get some of that additional planning time. Because as we know, I mean, teachers spend a lot of time with their own personal time doing some of this, a lot of this stuff, right? From grading to God knows whatever else. And their days are usually much longer than people realize.
Did you have a question?
I just have a comment more than anything. I just happened to see a video last night. I can't remember a local district that was certified as a District of Innovation. And they precisely moved the start week a week earlier, allowing them to have a fall break. And from what I saw or what I heard there, there's studies that show that when there's a break in several breaks throughout the year, it allows children to learn better. There's, you know, that kind of stuff. So I kind of like what I saw in that video. Starting in a week earlier, giving the students and teachers a fall break in October.
And those are all things we definitely want to look at. And again, with this committee that depends, you know, if you approve this and approve the committee, those are the types of things that we want to discuss with the committee and just ultimately make sure that whatever we decide, it's good for our kids, but also for our teachers as well.
Yeah, I saw that same video, and it's really cool. The one question mark I had was, now, you know, the households both parents were,
But you didn't have the vacation before school starts, or when, school's already in session, or before school, right?
They're basically taking it from summer and putting it in the middle of school.
Yeah, it's a shift.
Yep.
How the kids
would like
it.
I don't know.
Well, it sounds like it gives more flexibility for us to make better decisions on our calendar. I saw the same video, and what you can do.
Could you have the video sent around? I'll take a look at that. Yeah, anything that allows
for higher fidelity in the classroom and allows a teacher to deliver.
And there may be things that we're not thinking about as an administrative team. We have good representation on that.
Any other questions from the board? All right, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Motion carries. All right, at this time we're gonna close our regular meeting to open a public hearing. Can I have a motion for adjournment? Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please raise your hand. I will call to order. Open session in the boardroom for the District of Innovation public hearing. Sorry, 10 o'clock. Do we have any citizen input at this time?
John? Anybody? Somebody?
We just called it out, Shannon.
Not seeing any citizen input. Adjourn, right? Okay. I need a motion to adjourn the public hearing.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? Motion carries. At 10 o'clock. Now I will open session for the continuation of the regular board meeting at 10 o'clock. I was going to try to wait 30 seconds to get 10:01, but.
10:01.
Do you have 10? Okay, 10:01, according to Mr. Montemore. All right, we'll now go on to action items. Discuss and approve the District of Innovation District Advisory Committee appointment.
President Myers, board members, thank you for approving the resolution. We're excited about that. We think this is going to be great for our kids and our district moving forward. The next thing that I would like to ask is the committee that we would like to use for our District of Innovation Committee is our District Educational Improvement Council. And the reason that we want to use this committee is because it's a well-balanced committee. It has very good teacher representation from every campus, all levels, as well as community members. And we've actually added some community members. We have a UEA representative on there, which I believe will be good to have that perspective from a teacher organization. We've added some additional community members. And I believe you have the names of everyone that is on that committee, including the additional names. And we did meet with the DEIC committee last week, and we did let them know that we are going to bring that committee before the board, recommend that be the DEI, the District of Innovation Committee.
I need a motion to approve the District of Innovation District Advisory Committee appointments.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any questions, Mr. English?
So my question around the process for the communication, I assume that once the teachers meet with the committees, they'll take the information back to school. How's that whole process supposed to work?
That's a great question. Yes, after that initial meeting, they'll go back to their campus. We anticipate this happening over multiple meetings. We don't know the exact number of meetings at this point because we're not quite sure how fast they're going to move and really what we want to focus on. And I alluded to the calendar. That is definitely something we're going to discuss up front. So I'm not sure about the number of meetings, but yes, they'll go back to their campuses and report back to their campuses on what we want to do to get input from teachers on grade levels and the entire campus.
And what is the plan to publicize the committee information out to the public so they're aware also?
After the, what we will do, we will post the committee member names on our website along with a plan that's actually recommended for the board. And then that will be posted for 30 days and then we'll come back to the board for approval. Vote on it. Once the board votes, then that plan is in effect for 5 years.
Okay. And before that, with the committee members, the meeting that happens as they conduct these meetings, that information, is that also publicized on the website, or how is that communicated to the community so they're widely aware?
Yeah, and we're going to work on developing a website. In fact, that's one of the requirements for districts of innovation is they have to have a website that has really all of the information. We want to be as transparent as possible with this. So that is one thing that we will be required to do is post our plan, and then in addition to the plan, the steps that we've taken.
Any other questions? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gallagher. Next up, discuss and approve FTE administrative tech, Ms. Epps.
Good evening, Madam President, board members, and Dr. Strike. Your original documentation says that the administration wanted to recommend four positions. I'm going to ask that we pull one, and the administration will recommend the approval of three administrative level positions. Two would be for technology, and one for the safety and security student services position.
Okay. I need a motion for the board to approve three administrative level positions. Do you want me to read it as a whole?
Since she presented as three, then the motion could be.
Instead of saying as submitted, you say as presented.
Thank you for interrupting. Let me start over. I need a motion for the board to approve three administrative level positions, two technology, and one student service safety and security as submitted, as presented. I'm sorry. You guys screwed me up anyway. Thank you. Do I have a second?
Second.
All right. Any discussion or questions?
Three.
Yeah. No questions? Okay. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Ms. Epps. All right. Next up, discuss and approve financial reports. Mr. Anderson.
We have the October financials, and you see that your board packets, and this will be a brief summary of them. Budget amendments include all the amendments through December 2016, and the major budget amendment is $1,082,574 to complete the cost of projects from 2015-16. And this is the items that were budgeted in 2015-16, like the renovation projects and some athletic expenditures and music and band that were rolled forward into the new fiscal year. And now go directly against the fund balance that we realized in 2015-16. So I want to recap again the fund balance analysis. That 2015-16, the estimate, which was also reflected in the audit report that our independent auditor reported to you all today, added $3,796,314 to fund balance. We had already budgeted at $1.5 million for the high school renovation project out of our fund balance. And then last month, we did the employee bonus, which was about $1.1 million. And then again, we add the projects, about $1.1 million, that's rolled forward from 2015-16. So in the 2016-17 proposed budget, we have $3.8 million deficit. And again, you can see the 2015-16, that's really going against the 2015-16 fund balance we added. And they're all, each of those items are one-time expenditures. And our discretionary fund balance is $1.9. And that's up with all the allocations that we've set to protect the district and keep the district financially stable. And this is our October financial, or September, of course, started the initial budget, $61.6 million. We've had in our estimated revenue, and we're at our proposed amendments, and so we just added $11,000 in October to our estimated revenue. That's $61,694,000 estimated revenue. Went up there very much. And again, our campus level functions, we're at 78.4% of our total appropriations. And this is our appropriation, $61.6 million. And you can see the proposed amendment is going to be fund balance by $1.1 million. Our year-to-date amendments, $2,648,000. And $1.1 million deficit of, again, $3,832,075. And this is just a summary of our total revenue and expenditures. We've realized to date 13% of our estimated revenue, $8.1 million, and our total expenditures, which also includes encumbrances, about 22% of the budget. And this is the $1.5 million that was transferred out to our capital project fund. And this is just our cash flow that we spent down about $1.6 million in the current fiscal year. So we have $52 million in bank investments. And these are the summer projects that I think most of them are all have been completed right now, and this is our getting to our final, where we get all the contractors and raw material, and this is where we stand. And this is the two capital projects at the high school and operational facility, 21.5. It's spent about $3.4 million to date. And the operational facility is mainly architectural fees, $355,000. And see the rest of the financials are in your board packet. The administration recommends approval of the October 2016 financial reports.
I need a motion for the board to approve the October 2016 financial reports as presented.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any questions?
Thank you.
No questions? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed?
Motion carries.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. All right, next up, discuss and approve Little Elm ISD Education Foundation Memorandum of Understanding. Ms. Robbins.
Good evening, Board of Trustees and Dr. Strike. Both Melissa Myers and David Montemayor are on the board, so they have seen this Memorandum of Understanding. The new foundation that has evolved from all of our work is very diligently considering the district's mission and the district's needs as they build their mission. I added to your stack this one pager about the foundation, and as you see, if you look at their mission, the mission of the Little Elm ISD Education Foundation is to partner with the community to provide resources that enrich teaching, inspire learning, and maximize innovative opportunities so that every student in LEISD can realize their full potential. And we have funding priorities. And the Memorandum of Understanding really talks to the fact that everything that they do will continue to support and enhance what we are trying to do as a district. Within here, they talk about the fact that all of the support we provide them will be exceeded by the monetary gifts and support that they give us. Dr. Strike and I and the board of director or the board of directors of the foundation reviewed this memorandum of understanding, and then we forwarded it on to Carol Simpson, who reviewed it and made some changes. We reviewed it with their board, and they accepted all of the changes, and now we're bringing it to you for signatures. So the administration recommends that the Little Elm ISD Board of Trustees approve the Memorandum of Understanding with the Little Elm ISD Education Foundation.
All right, I need a motion from the board to approve the Memorandum of Understanding with the Little Elm ISD Education Foundation. Second?
Second.
Any questions for Ms. Robbins?
No. Glad to see that. This was awesome.
Yeah, I don't have any questions. I'm excited to be a part of it. I think it's a great group of people. It's being led by President Mr. Griffin, who's, I think, going to be integral in getting funding and getting the word out. And I think everybody that I've met so far on the board is exceptional. They're very devoted to the kids in the district and our teachers and staff, and I'm excited to be a part of it.
We're really excited. Things are moving along pretty quickly. All we need is that donate button now.
All right, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Robbins. All right, up next, consent agenda. Anything need to be pulled?
Questions, concerns?
All right, I need a motion to approve consent as submitted. Do I have a second? Any questions? All right, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Motion carries. All right, last item, comments. So TASB continuing education credit report, we're happy to report that all board members have completed the educational credits necessary and as needed by TASB. Thank you all for doing that this year. What's that? Yeah. The other item that I wanted to bring forward is just the board procedures. I know that we had talked about updating board procedures. Mr. Olson, did you have any updates on that?
Yeah, the committee is going to be getting back together here shortly. We took away from our last meeting to go through the bylaws, make kind of comments to each other. I'm going to take Mr. English's and Mr. Blackwood's comments, put them together, probably come back to the board. Hopefully, I'll probably say, let's say February to be on the safe side. Give it a little, make sure with the holidays and everything coming up, we'll hopefully come back to February meeting with maybe some more feedback for the board to review.
Thank you for that update. I'll make a note to just bring it, put it back on the agenda for February.
Yeah, it's good.
If you need to change that, just let us know. All right, the other item that I had on here is Team of Eight training. I wanted to bring this to the board. When I first came on, we did, and you guys are gonna have to refresh my memory, we did a CRSS training,
yes.
A Team of Eight. Was that a Team of Eight?
No, CRSS was not Team of Eight.
That's where we went to Chicago and trained. Yes. So, but they do, I believe they do offer a Team of Eight training.
What, CRSS?
No, they don't?
Because I don't even know if CRSS is even still around. Are they still around or not?
I've been checking their website for that training. They do want to attend, and they, yeah.
I noticed it hasn't been posted. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, the other option, I think we did a Team of Eight, was it with Plano ISD? Ms. Bender?
Yeah, she's still our
so we don't want to do that. Well, I wanted to put it out there to see if anybody had interest, if you wanted us to look at some possibility of some training dates.
We didn't fall last year, did we?
That's right.
Probably a little bit just depends on what topically. I mean, Team of Eight training can be pretty wide open.
Right.
I mean, it could be team building even as a Team of Eight. So it just depends on what you all are most interested in. Region 11 does Team of Eight training. There's other people out there that are certified to be able to do it. So it's just a matter of what maybe topical you want to know, and then go find the individuals that might deliver that the best.
Okay.
That are certified to deliver it.
Well, if the board wants to just, if members want to provide some topics that you might be interested in, we can see if there's a general consensus.
Why don't I have, Sonia can email everybody and just ask, what would you be interested in topically? And then we can go out and do a search for whom might be the best to deliver that, if that's okay with y'all.
Yeah, I think that would be good, and we might find.
That way, at least, if somebody coming in delivering, it's like, oh yeah, that was nice.
Right.
It's something you feel like, hey, that was worth spending, you know, a couple, 3 hours listening to.
Yeah. Does Team of Eight count towards your education credits? So I thought that, that might be an inexpensive, less expensive way than all of us traveling out somewhere else as well. So, okay. That would be excellent. Let's see. That was all the comments I had, so I'll open it up to board comments. Mr. English?
I have nothing.
Mr. Blackwood?
Yeah, just a couple real quick. Had a chance over the weekend to go see the New Horizons Theater, the White Crystal production. It is really, really good. Don't know who all got to make it, but I'd like to congratulate that group. Also, I haven't really seen this make the rounds yet, but another big congratulations to our academic decathlon team. Over the weekend, they ended up going to San Antonio, placed first overall as a group, and got the top three individual placements at the ACDET meeting. So, really, really proud of them for that. So.
Thank you, Mr. Murphy. Morris?
Yes, we have the Angel Tree this coming Wednesday. I'd like to invite all of my fellow board members to. Are we at Zeller's or where are we at this week?
Powell
this year at 5:30, Pat, or?
5:30.
Yes.
5:30. So, great opportunity. When's Wednesday?
Powell.
In between kind of the two buildings.
I want to invite all of you to participate in that. Also, just want to wish everyone a very Merry Christmas.
Mr. Montemayor.
I don't have anything major, just wanted to wish, you know, the administration and staff a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Thank you for all the hard work for the first half of this academic year, and hopefully they'll get some rest and relaxation and get ready to hit the ground running and come January. So, Happy New Year. Merry Christmas.
That's pretty much me. I just want to say Merry Christmas. You guys have a great holiday vacation. Whatever y'all decide to do, I sleep usually when I have days off, so if you're like me. But today, today was very exciting. The LINC program, getting a review on that one, the Education Foundation, that's awesome. I hope the band had a great show tonight. Police. Tomorrow's the choir concert, in case anybody wants to go to that one. Oh, see, there's another thing for your list. But anyway, everybody, Merry Christmas. Mr. Katinka, you too. And you guys over there, Merry Christmas. Y'all have a great time, and I'll see y'all next month. So, okay, Mr.
Man, y'all took three of my items between you and Dan.
Man.
But I still got a few, huh, that you missed. The high school art show was awesome. If y'all were not able to attend, the great thing was is that they took up basically two hallways, and they still had tons of artwork they did not put out. But some nice ones, just a couple shout-outs. Brittany Stover, Donay Martinez, Alexander Aguirre, and Sarah Olette. I like their artwork. There's some really cool stuff out there. Great to see, and a very much a wide variety from our freshmen to our seniors. I mean, there was categories everywhere that were going on. Congratulations, Coach Brown, for being Coach of the Year. The TW Pioneers event was awesome at the high school, so if y'all weren't able to attend that, it was awesome to see everybody. On the 15th, Chavez is getting recognized at town council, so that's good for them, being recognized by town. And don't forget the middle school and high school basketball games on Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday.
This week. Or at least middle school is not playing.
Middle school's not playing this week. I think they started back up in January, but I know our high schoolers are going Tuesday and Friday because the girls actually have a tournament, I think, like on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, I think, is their tournament, or Wednesday, Thursday, Friday.
Playing over break.
Yeah, over break. It's like the 28th, 29th, and 30th.
They're
playing the tournament. So, no break for the girls or the boys. But I think that's it. Other than that, same as everyone, happy Christmas and New Year's to everybody. We don't see you between now and then. Thank you for all you do.
Well, man, I can say happy Merry Christmas.
Too late.
Jeez.
Too late.
We already passed. We already passed you.
Hey, nobody said Happy New Year yet.
Too late.
I did. Oh.
David did too.
Nobody said Happy Christmas.
Dr. Strike.
Happy Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Happy New Year.
Feliz Navidad.
Merry New Year.
Dr. Strike, any comments?
No, Jason took all mine. So I'm good.
We'll start
Merry Christmas
next
to everybody. How's that?
One time I had to take all Jason's stuff.
Yeah, he did. I just started scratching stuff off when he started talking. So
yeah, next time I will look over and go.
Go make something up.
Yeah.
I'll make a mental note that we'll start with you starting next year.
There you go. We'll wait till next year.
Well, I second everybody. Thank you all for a fabulous year. I cannot imagine all of the work you guys have done and put into everything that's been accomplished in 2016. I'm looking forward to 2017. It's going to be even greater. But thank you for all your hard work, your tireless hours, you know, listening to us until 10:30 at night. We appreciate your time and being here with us. With that, I need a motion to adjourn.
So adjourn.
Let me start over. I need a motion to adjourn. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please raise your hand. All right, we are adjourned. Any opposed? 10:26.
You never record my opposition to close the meeting. Never.